everyone, and welcome back to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service's Conservation Connect. Today, we're going to connect you with bats and the careers of people who study and try to help bats. Bats are extraordinary creatures, and they play such an important role in our ecosystem. Did you know that bats help farmers every year by eating so many insects, the farmers are actually able to use less chemical pesticides on our crops? In fact, a little brown bat mother can eat more than her own body weight every single night. Now that is a lot of insects. Imagine if you had to eat your own body weight every day and still be able to fly through the night sky. Some bats have evolved a highly complex sense of hearing. They actually send off sounds that bounce off objects in their path, sending echoes back to themselves. Now from these echoes, the bats can determine the size of objects, how far away they are, how fast they're traveling, and even their texture. This is all in just a split second. But bats are also in need of our help. Several species have become critically endangered, and many populations in caves have been entirely wiped out. Today, to tell us more about this, we have with us Ann Froschauer and Leslie Sturges. Ann, can you tell us what you do?
Sure, I'm a science communicator and a bat specialist with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service.
And Leslie?
I am a wildlife rehabilitator who specializes in bats and the president of the Save Lucy campaign.
Great. Now, because bats are very susceptible to an absolutely horrible disease, which actually Leslie and Ann will talk to us about in just a moment, we're going to show you live bats, but we're actually going to show you these live bats back at our studio at the National Conservation Training Center. We are back in the studio, back from the cave, and I have Leslie here with the bat. Leslie, can you tell us what you have in your hand?
This is an adult male big brown bat. He is one of our residents. This is our largest summer bat in the area, and right now he is trying to hibernate.
Very cool.
What I'm feeding him is called NutriCal. It's actually a very gummy substance that's made of sugar and fat and a little malt flavoring.
And Ann, what do we have over here?
This is a hoary bat, a female hoary bat. This is a migratory bat species. They are found in this area normally during the summertime. This time of year she would be going south for the winter to find insects to eat. And
very
we can
nice.
Give her
can
a mealworm. Yeah.
Look at guys, all these live mealyworms. Oh. Let's see. Can you take that?
There,
all right.
She's got it.
So this is Tiny Bat. He's a eastern tricolored bat, formerly known as an eastern pipistrelle. This is one of our smallest species. He's fully grown. And he's actually a little small even for his species. He weighs about 4.5 grams. So we think he might be a little thirsty. I'm going to go ahead and give him a little water.
Okay.
Let's see if he's thirsty.
And Leslie, I'm going to grab a piece of equipment that I see that I'm curious about while you're doing that.
Oh, here we go.
And Leslie, can you tell me what this device is?
Yeah, this is called a bat detector. And it allows us to hear bats' ultrasonic calls, which, as you know, are too high for humans to hear. But that machine brings them down into our range of hearing.
Very cool. Can we give it a try?
Sure. You can go ahead and turn that on.
Okay.
And then you want to turn it so that, there you go. And then we're going to try and hand Tiny Bat a mealworm and see what he does. So the clicking you heard was actually his ultrasonic calls. So we're going to have Ann come in here and offer him, this is a preferred treat, and they know they get it when they do education programs. Mm-hmm.
That's the good stuff. And Ann, can you talk to me about why these devices are important to have?
Sure. Actually, one way that we use bat detectors is in monitoring hibernating bat populations, and bat populations in the spring, summer, and fall when they're mating and in their maternity colonies. We use the bat detectors so that we don't have to disturb the bats as much. We're able to monitor them using sound rather than having to capture and handle them or go into the hibernacula where they're hibernating, which causes an additional disturbance, which can be problematic for bats that are trying to get through the winter on a limited amount of fat.
Sure. Well, we're coming back from the studio, back to the cave, and as you can see, we're right in front of one now. Ann, can you tell us, I'm seeing these bars kind of blocking the cave. What's going on with that?
Well, we oftentimes gate caves that have bat populations in them or other sensitive cave ecosystems, because human disturbance can cause a lot of problems for hibernating bats or for bats that have maternity colonies in caves. So this prevents humans from going in when they shouldn't be in the cave, disturbing bats or destroying sensitive cave features.
Leslie, can you talk to us a little bit about why bats are so vital to the ecosystem?
Well, bats are incredibly necessary to the ecosystem because they just eat huge numbers of insects. So if you can imagine that every plant around us, every leaf on every tree, every vegetable has an insect predator that eats it, bats are eating those insects. And so they're protecting our forests, they're protecting our fruits, our vegetables. They're just giving us so much just because they eat bugs.
Great. Yeah, that is amazing. Now, our viewers are watching, and I wanted to ask you both, what can they do to help bats and help protect them?
Well, I think one of the most important things that anyone can do to protect bats is to help protect the habitat, to help pull invasive plants to pick up litter, and also to spread the good word about bats. Bats really need people to speak up for them.
Great. And Ann?
Well, you might notice that we all have on rubber boots today as we're standing here outside of the cave. And one of the things that's important about this disease, white nose syndrome, is that we do believe that humans can potentially track the fungus that causes the disease back and forth. So for cave explorers and for researchers also, it's really important before you go to visit a cave or a mine that you check and make sure that that place is open and you're allowed to visit, but also that you decontaminate your clothing and footwear and gear both before and after you visit the cave. So we're not going inside the cave today, so we just have these rubber boots on as a precaution. We'll take them back and decontaminate them and make sure that we're not accidentally tracking any fungus that might be here at this cave to any other areas.
Now, Leslie, you mentioned that you were the head and founder of the Save Lucy campaign. What exactly is that?
Well, we do a lot of education of the public about bats, and we work hard on bat conservation. And Lucy is actually a mascot. She represents little brown bats because that's the species that we're so concerned about right now in the face of white nose syndrome.
Now, if you're interested in helping bats, another thing you can do is help build a bat house. All you have to do is go to the National Wildlife Federation website. It'll show you on your screen right now, www.nwf.org, and simply type in how to build a bat house in the search engine. Enjoy and help spread the word. We'll see you next time on Conservation Connect.